Mrs. Packletide's tiger. It was Mrs. Packletide's pleasure and intention that she should shoot a tiger. Not that the lust to kill had suddenly descended on her, or that she felt it would leave India safer and more wholesome than she had found it, with one fraction less of wild beast per million of inhabitants. The compelling motive for her sudden deviation towards the footsteps of Nimrod was the fact that Luna Bimberton had recently been carried 11 miles in an aeroplane by an Algerian aviator and talked of nothing else. Only a personally procured tiger skin and a heavy harvest of press photographs could successfully counter that sort of thing. Mrs. Packletide had already arranged in her mind the lunch that she would give at her house in Curzon Street, ostensibly in Luna Bimberton's honour, with a tiger skin rug occupying most of the foreground and all of the conversation. She had also already designed in her mind the tiger claw brooch that she was going to give Luna Bimberton on her next birthday. In a world that is supposed to be chiefly swayed by hunger and by love, Mrs. Packletide was an exception. Her movements and motives were largely governed by dislike of Luna Bimberton. Circumstances proved propitious. Mrs. Packletide had offered 1,000 rupees for the opportunity of shooting a tiger without overmuch risk or exertion, and it so happened that a neighbouring village could boast of being the favoured rendezvous of an animal of respectable antecedents, which had been driven by the increasing infirmities of age to abandon game-killing and confine its appetite to the smaller domestic animals. The prospect of earning the 1,000 rupees had stimulated the sporting and commercial instinct of the villagers. Children were posted night and day on the outskirts of the local jungle to head the tiger back in the unlikely event of his attempting to roam away to fresh hunting grounds, and the cheaper kinds of goats were left about with elaborate carelessness to keep him satisfied with his present quarters. The one great anxiety was lest he should die of old age before the date appointed for the Memsahib's shoot. Mothers carrying their babies home through the jungle after the day's work in the fields hushed their singing lest they might curtail the restful sleep of the venerable herd-robber. The great night duly arrived, moonlit and cloudless. A platform had been constructed in a comfortable and conveniently placed tree, and thereon crouched Mrs. Packletide and her paid companion, Miss Mebbin. A goat, gifted with a particularly persistent bleat, such as even a partially deaf tiger might be reasonably expected to hear on a still night, was tethered at the correct distance. With an accurately sighted rifle and a thumbnail pack of patience cards, the sportswoman awaited the coming of the quarry. "I suppose we are in some danger," said Miss Mebbin. She was not actually nervous about the wild beast, but she had a morbid dread of performing an atom more service than she had been paid for. "Nonsense," said Mrs. Packletide. "It's a very old tiger. It couldn't spring up here, even if it wanted to."
"If it's an old tiger, I think you ought to get it cheaper. 1,000 rupees is a lot of money."
Louisa Mebbin adopted a protective elder-sister attitude towards money in general, irrespective of nationality or denomination. Her energetic intervention had saved many a rouble from dissipating itself in tips in some Moscow hotel, and francs and centimes clung to her instinctively under circumstances which would have driven them headlong from less sympathetic hands. Her speculations as to the market depreciation of tiger remnants were cut short by the appearance on the scene of the animal itself. As soon as it caught sight of the tethered goat, it lay flat on the earth, seemingly less from a desire to take advantage of all available cover than for the purpose of snatching a short rest before commencing on the grand attack.
"I believe it's ill,"
said Louisa Mebbin, loudly in Hindustani, for the benefit of the village headman who was in ambush in a neighbouring tree.
"Hush!"
said Mrs. Packletide, and at that moment the tiger commenced ambling towards its victim.
"Now, now!" urged Miss Mebbin with some excitement. "If he doesn't touch the goat, we needn't pay for it!"
The bait was an extra.
The rifle flashed out with a loud report, and the great tawny beast sprang to one side and then rolled over in the stillness of death.
In a moment a crowd of excited natives had swarmed upon the scene, and their shouting speedily carried the glad news to the village, where a thumping of tom-toms took up the chorus of triumph. And their triumph and rejoicing found a ready echo in the heart of Mrs. Packletide. Already that luncheon party in Curzon Street seemed immeasurably nearer. It was Louisa Mebbin who drew attention to the fact that the goat was in death throes from a mortal bullet wound, whilst no trace of the rifle's deadly work could be found on the tiger. Evidently the wrong animal had been hit, and the beast of prey had succumbed to heart failure, caused by the sudden report of the rifle, accelerated by senile decay. Mrs. Packletide was pardonably annoyed at the discovery, but at any rate she was the possessor of a dead tiger, and the villagers, anxious for their 1,000 rupees...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.